Hope you are all doing well, and slowly and gradually you are progressing in your studies as time is passing by. So here I am with a new video of class 11, chapter 1, The Living World. So this chapter has subdivided into three parts. The first introductory part, today I am going to discuss about the various characteristics of a living organism. In the next video, I will be discussing about the various taxonomical hierarchy of classification. And the third video, I will be describing about the keys of identification, like herbarium, zoo, museum, so all these things. So hope you will find it interesting. So watch it. Hello children. Hope you all are well. Now today I am going to introduce a new topic of class 11, the living world. It is the very first chapter of your syllabus. Now in this chapter we will study about various comparative features of living and non-living things. Now how we will differentiate a living from a non-living object. Now here are some of the basic things that I want to discuss here. First is, you see, we have to understand this world, Earth, is a home of diverse form of living organisms, isn't it? We can see various type of snails, insects crawling around, we can see fishes, we can see birds, various plants around us. So all these comprises the diverse form of living organism around us. Now you see, each and every organism, I was talking about snail, earthworm or fish or plant, every organism has its specific habitat. You know well that what is a habitat? Habitat is the dwelling place of an organism. Now basically you see, every living organism lives in its own habitat. It may be a mountain, it may be a forest, it may be a desert or an ocean. But you see, all these habitats may differ from each other, but in common, in general, all organisms have some basic characteristics. And that basic characteristics make a object, or you can see, make a thing living. So these basic characteristics are same in all living organisms. Clear? Now what are these major basic characteristics on the living organisms? Now these basic characteristics, which are mainly discussed in this chapter, that make the living organism differentiate from the non-living object. So how can you see that, how can you say that yes, this object lying on the road is living, or that object lying in the corner is a non-living? Now for that we have to study the major basic characteristics. Now here I am with some of the major basic characteristics that define an object as living. Now growth, reproduction, metabolism, cellular organization and consciousness. Now these are the few five basic characteristics that make an object living. Now apart from these five important major characteristics, there are few more characteristics, like you see, size of an organism, shape of an organism, life cycle of an organism, movement, self-regulation, variation, adaptation, healing and repair, excretion and death. So all these also are contributed in this major basic characteristics, but here these five are the primary ones that will be discussed here in this topic. Now I will discuss one by one as the major basic characteristics to identify an object as living or dead or a non-living object. First is growth. Now what do we generally mean by growth? Growth is actually the increase in the mass or increase in the number of the cell of an individual. Now in a multicellular organism, you see, growth occurs by cell division. Clear? Or in the increase in the number of the cell. But what in case of the non-living things? Now right, in non-living things, you see, you may say that, well, a sand dune also grow. A sand dune grow, a heap of sand is seen in the desert. But do you, don't you think that this sand dune grow externally? All the sand accumulate together and it forms a sand dune. So non-living things also, like mountain, boulder, sand dunes, they also grow. But they grow just by accumulation of material in its external surface. So thus growth in living things is internal, while growth in non-living things is external growth. So it must be accompanied by the specific condition under which it is observed in the living organism. So this is about growth. Okay, now it is also be noted that a dead organism does not grow. Clear? So this is about growth. So we cannot, you see, can we say that yes, growth is only the defining character of a living organism? Not at all. Here we see that here living, apart from living organism, sand dune is also growing. So we cannot only say that growth is the major driving. Well children, the next topic is reproduction. Now you very well know what is reproduction. Now reproduction is the characteristics of a living organism in which the offsprings are produced of its own kind. Clear? Now in multicellular organism, you see, what is the mode of reproduction? Sexual reproduction. But in case of most of the organisms or unicellular organisms, some of the multicellular as well, asexual mode of reproduction is also seen. Clear? Now you see here, some living organisms, they are reproduced by asexual methods. Now I want to discuss it for you. First you see some fungus. Some fungi, they multiply and spread very fast. Now how do they multiply very fast? Because they produce spores. Now these spores are asexual spores. Clear? Now these asexual spores of fungus, they produce in millions. Okay, sometimes some fungi, they have like the filamentous algae, you know, Spirogyra. Spirogyra is a filamentous algae that multiply by fragmentation, which is an asexual means. Okay, now yeast, hydra, they shows budding, isn't it? So hydra and yeast, they show budding. Whereas your planaria, you see flatworm, they show regeneration property. That is, the fragmented body grows into a new individual organism. So in this way, you see, there are so many types of asexual mode of reproduction, even in multicellular organisms. Now, unicellular organisms like bacteria, algae, amoeba, they generally reproduce by increasing the number of cell. How this increase takes place? Through cell division. That is, growth here is synchronized with reproduction. So here we can say that reproduction and growth are both synchronized and correlated. Clear? So in some organism, here if you consider the reproduction as a basic key factor for the characteristics that we will discuss as living or non-living, then I must say in these cases there are so many exceptions. Like you see the sterile or worker bees, isn't it? The worker bees, those who are sterile. Next come the mules, who are actually hybridization of ass and the horse. The infertile human couples, they do not reproduce ever. So hence, can we say that reproduction also is the major basic characteristics? So hence, reproduction also cannot be an inclusive defining character. So we cannot include reproduction as the major or the basic characteristics for defining life. As here, I have given some exceptions that do not come in the category of characterizing an organism as the major basic characteristics of reproduction. So however, it is an important defining characteristics. So we can say that yes, it is an important defining characteristics. So reproduction may be an important defining characteristics, but not the basic characteristics of an organism to decide whether it is living or non-living. Clear? Next come metabolism. Now you know what is metabolism. Metabolism is the sum total of all the chemical reactions taking place in an living organism. So metabolism is divided into two headings, that is catabolism and anabolism. Catabolism and anabolism. So what did I say about the metabolism? Metabolism is the sum total of all the chemical reactions taking place in a living cell. Now metabolism can be divided into two major aspects. So what are they? Catabolism and anabolism. Well, what is catabolism? Catabolism means the destructive reactions which occur continuously in our body. And anabolism is the kind of constructive reactions taking place in our body. Here I will want to give you an example. Like photosynthesis is an anabolic process where food is being synthesized. Where catabolism is, the example may be respiration, where glucose is burnt in the cell to produce energy. So are you clear about the definitions of catabolism and anabolism? So these are the
sum total that makes a metabolism. Clear?
You see, children, I was telling you about the metabolism. So metabolism is the sum total of all chemical reactions taking place in a living cell or a living body. So metabolism, we can hence say it is the sum total of catabolism plus anabolism. Now let me discuss about the differences of these two processes. So here I have written the differences of catabolism and anabolism. So catabolism is all the destructive processes taking place in our living body. Anabolism is all the constructive processes taking place in our living body. Catabolism, here you see what happens actually. Simpler substances are formed from complex one. Like glucose you are taking. Okay, now this is converted into ATP in the mitochondria. So this is the catabolism where simpler substances are formed from complex one. Well, in anabolism you see the complex substances are formed from the simpler one. Here you see the raw materials, carbon dioxide and water combined together to form the glucose, which is a complex carbohydrate. It is a simple monosaccharide, though it is a complex component, isn't it? Next, you see in catabolism, energy is released. During respiration, you know, energy is released. In anabolism, energy is stored. Clear? Now, catabolism is required for the performance of activities in a living cell, while anabolism is required for growth and maintenance of the living body. So this was about the differences between catabolism and anabolism. Next, I will discuss about cellular organization. Now, what do you mean by cellular organization? You very well know from class 8, you are reading about the cell, the structure of cell and the various components of cell. Now, you very well know that every living organisms have cell. So, cell are the building block of any living organism, including plant, animal, microbes. Clear? Now, you see, in unicellular organism, a single cell is the organism. While in multicellular organisms, we know millions of cells or trillions of cells are there in a multicellular body. Now, what does cell contain? What is the living content of the cell? That is protoplasm. So protoplasm, you know very well, what is protoplasm? This is the living matter of the cell. So protoplasm means, what is protoplasm? Nucleus and cytoplasm together comprises protoplasm. So here I can tell you, when Robert Hooke discovered cell, could he view the protoplasm in the cork? No. Because he viewed a dead cell which was prepared from the bark of a birch tree. So protoplasm is the living content of the cell, which is found only in the living cells. It cannot be found in a dead cell, right? So you see, this protoplasm play an important role in all controlling all the vital activities in a unicellular organism. And in multicellular organism, the every cell contains protoplasm that carry on its individual function, right? Next come the consciousness. Well, consciousness, you see, every organism, they may be a prokaryotic organism or bacteria, even a bacterium or a multicellular elephant, every living organism has consciousness in the living form. So that means they respond to various type of physical, chemical and biological stimuli. You very well know what is a stimuli. Stimuli means what? Stimuli means any factor, that means any type of agent like chemical or any type of physical or any biological agent that create a response in a living body, that is a stimuli. So every living organism, whether an unicellular amoeba or a multicellular elephant, every living organism is they respond to stimuli. Okay, so the various type of physical factors to which this living organism respond, they are light, temperature, water, pollutants, even to other organisms also they respond. So clear? Now here I would want to tell you about some of the stimuli and their effect on the living organisms. So well, children, I was talking about consciousness. Now you see, in case of consciousness, I told you that various factors, that is various abiotic factors,
like light, temperature, water, pollutants. These play an important role for defining that whether the organism is conscious to its environment. Now, like light duration or photoperiod. This photoperiod or light duration, it affects many seasonal breeders, including plants also and animal as well as. So all living things, they respond to certain chemicals also that is entering into their body. So all living organisms respond to various type of abiotic factors. Now human beings, they are superior ones to all living organisms. Why we will say that human beings are superior in comparison to all other organisms? Because human beings have the ability of self-consciousness. Now what is self-consciousness? Now human beings are not only conscious about their various type of abiotic or biotic stimuli. They are also conscious about themselves or their homeostasis. They also become conscious about their ability of having, they have the ability of self-consciousness. So here you see, consciousness can be considered a defining property of living organisms. Clear? Because non-living organisms are not conscious. We cannot fit this property in non-living objects. Now, however, you see, human beings, it is very difficult. In this case also, there are some exceptions. Now, how will you define a person, okay, living when he is in the state of coma? Now, we often see the doctor says when a person is in coma, he is in vegetative state. What does it mean? That means his all body parts are working, which is supported by machines that replace the heart, that replace the lungs, that replace the various type of body organ system. The brain is dead. So he has no consciousness with the environment, or he cannot communicate with the surrounding world. So here also there are some exceptions. Clear? Next come body organization. This is one of the next important property. Now see, every living organism is made up of the tiny structural and functional unit called cell. Now if we compare cell, you see within the cell, in all the organelles, cellular activities are going on. So all the cell aggregate to form a cellular colony. In case of unicellular like aggregation of various type of cells, here you see when the organisms live in a colony, so cellular aggregation is their colony, right? Now in case of multicellular organism, what do we see? The cell form the tissue form the organ, organ form the organ system comprises to form the organism. So all these these tissues, organ, organ system, these play a major role in the biological activity of the living organism. And cell play as a major role in the cellular activity. Now let us see what's about the non-living world. Now you know, non-living world are made up of atoms and molecules. Now the atom is made up of proton, neutron and electron. So here you see, we can compare the body organization of an organism by its physical and biological hierarchies. So there is a physical, that is a non-living hierarchy, as well as a biological or living hierarchy of the living organism. A physical hierarchy, like the non-living components that I am telling about, atoms and molecules. Okay, they aggregate to form a compound which finally enters in the living world. For example, our body is made up of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, right? The major component of all the living world is carbon. We often say, often use this word, carbon world. Why do we say? Because carbon is the ultimate source where all living organisms is made up of. Now, carbon is an inorganic element. Isn't it? It is a physical world. This carbon is entering our body and it is aggregated in our system, in our cells. So each cell is made up of many complementalized cell organelles. So every cell organelle has its specific location and specific function. So they are complementalized in a cell. Clear? Now these cell organelle, they form a basic structure called cell. Clear? So I was talking about the living world and the non-living world. So all the elements that are the non-living elements, like various type of chemicals or the non-living elements, they enter the living world. Okay, so every cell is made up of some organelles which are compartmentalized. They play a major role, and this cell organized to form tissues, and thereafter tissues organized to form organs, and several organs form organ system. Finally, these many organ system organize together to form an organism. Now you see the property of a tissue. So the tissue like blood. Blood is a connective tissue, you know. Blood is a fluid in nature. It is a fluid connective tissue. Again, you see bone. It is also connective tissue. But what is the nature? It is unlike the blood. It is not fluid. So you will see tissues may be of various type. They may be performing various type of functions. Where one tissue is fluid, another tissue may be hard and it may be playing some other role in the body organization. So you see that property of a tissue vary from each other. Like that, when a tissue is made up of all the cells, aggregate of cells like osteocyte cells form a bone cell. Now, can you tell me that do these osteocyte cells have the same property of that of the tissue that is bone? No, it is not. So you see the properties of a tissue are not present in the constituent of the cell. But you see they arise as a result of interactions among the constituent of cell. So that just now that I told that bone. Bone is a hard tissue which provides framework to the body. But the cells that are present inside the bone, do they have this property? No. So these phenomena of interaction between various components of the body, this result in the hierarchy of organisms. I think you are clear now. Now you see the various life processes that I was talking about. Growth, okay, reproduction, metabolism, cellular organization, consciousness, body organizations. All these life processes, okay, including you see reproduction and growth, including this. You can add some other also activities that I told, excretion, circulation. So all these life activities or life processes, they are a result of the interactions. Interactions between whom? Interaction between the various type of components and as well as the coordination about the coordination of various type of this life processes. So the life processes coordinate together. So this complexity of the organism, every organism is not simple. Some organisms are very complex. So the complexity of the organisms that enables the living organism to self-replicate, to evolve, like in say a case of you see sexually reproducing organism. Sexually reproducing organism, they show variation. Why? Because they have involvement of gamete. And due to this variation, they show evolution. So due to this complexity, organisms evolve, they self-replicate, they self-regulate, and also they respond to various external stimuli. So every living organism along with their ancestors as well as descendants, they're linked together. Okay, how do they link together? Like for example, we the human beings. Our ancestors were the Neanderthal man. Our ancestors were the Cro-Magnon. These were the various evolution stages where the man evolved into. Now, our descendant may be some other organism which will be coming in the future 1 million years ago or more than that or less than that. So sometimes Homo sapiens sapiens will modify and evolve into some other organism. So that I was talking about, that all living organisms along with their ancestors and descendants, they are linked to one another. How they are linked to one another? By sharing the common genetic material in the form of DNA in the varying degrees. So this DNA is responsible for the expression of specific traits in the organisms. So I hope you understand this part of the physical and biological hierarchies of a living organism. So my dear children, I hope you understood the introductory part of the first chapter of class 11, The Living World. Here I have discussed about the all basic characteristics that define a thing as living. I have also compared about the various type of non-living objects and how will you differentiate between the living and the non-living world. I have given some exceptions here. I have discussed about the catabolic and anabolic pathways. Now you see this chapter is divided into three parts for me. I have just divided the chapter into three parts for three videos. First chapter, this is the introductory part. The second part will be systematics taxonomy. Okay, and then the last part will be the taxonomical aid. So for the further videos, you have to keep watching my videos and try to understand the topics. Thank you. Hi children, hope you understood and liked my video. I try to describe about the living world
the basic characteristic feature of the living organisms. So when you see the physical abiotic factors outside, it's raining outside, thunderstorm is going on. So the leaves are here shaking, okay. So the living world is the things that you are seeing around yourself. That's the whole environment, which is made of biotic and abiotic factors. So keep watching my video. If you like the content, you subscribe my video for the further videos which are upcoming now. And if you like it, you hope you understand. And if you think that yes, it should be shared with my friends, then please share it. So keep watching. Thank you.